Jazallahu bil khayrati anna a'immatan lana naqalu al-Qur'ana 'azban wa salsala faminhum budurun sab'atun qad tawasatat sama' al-'ula wal 'adli zuhran wa kummala.
Now inshallah ta'ala, my beloved brothers and sisters, we're going to go into the second group of views regarding al-ahruf al-sab'ah. We mentioned that the first camp or the first group, their opinion was very weak, and so it doesn't deserve mentioning. But I did mention it just so you know it and you understand why it's so weak. But the majority of the scholars, they mention it and they go over it fast. The second camp are a group of scholars whose view and idea and their interpretation and commentary on the hadith has weight. And it deserves to be looked at. It deserves to be given consideration. And this group are divided into two. And there are two views. I summarized it. I brought it back to two views. The first view are a group of scholars who said that the Ahruf al-Sab'ah is سَبْعَ لُغَاتْ مِنْ لُغَاتِ الْعَرَبِ الْمَشْهُورَةِ. It is seven dialect from the most prevalent dialects at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this view is attributed to the overwhelming majority of scholars of fiqh and hadith, like Sufyan ibn Uyayna, who died the year 198 Hijriyah. Also, it's attributed to Ibn Wahbin, who died the year 198 Hijriyah, 1 year after Sufyan ibn Uyayna, he died. Abu Ubaid al-Qasim ibn Salam, who died the year 224 Hijriyah. And Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, who died the year 310 Hijriyah. And Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi, who died the year 321 Hijriyah. And Ibn Abdul Barr, who died the year 463 Hijriyah. These scholars, they all said that the Ahruf al-Sab'ah, it means seven dialects from the dialects of the Arabs. And they said it's the seven most prevalent dialects within the Arabs. But those scholars I mentioned, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Ibn Wahbin, Abu Ubaid, Ibn Jarir, Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi, Ibn Abdul Barr and others, they differed amongst themselves in two things. Even though they agreed that it's seven dialects from the dialects of the Arabs, but they differed on two things. The first thing that they differed on is these seven dialects, are they dispersed and scattered and even spread out through the entirety of the Qur'an, or is it combined in a word? Is it combined in one word? They disputed one another in that matter. The first view, which argues that it's spread out and it's dispersed through the entirety of the Qur'an. Yani, part of the Qur'an is read in Quraysh, and part of it is read in the dialect of Thaqif, and part of it is read in the dialect of Hawazin, parts of it is read in the dialect of Hudayl. That's the first view, who are saying it's spread out like that. The second view, they're saying that it's combined in one word, meaning one word has many synonyms. Like, for example, the word halumma, wa aqbil, wa ta'al, wa ilayya, wa qasdi, wa nahwi, wa qurbi. Seven all mean the same, synonym to one another, similar in meaning. They're saying it's combined in one word like that. The view that says that it's spread out in the entirety of the Quran, or it's dispersed in the entirety of the Qur'an, that view is Abu Ubaid and those who agreed with him. Abu Ubaid al-Qasim al-Salam and those who agreed with him. The second view, which is it's combined in one word, yani one word has many synonyms, is the view that's attributed to Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, rahimahullah, Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi, and Ibn Abdul Barr, and other than them. They hold that opinion, that one word has different words, but they all have the same meaning, which is a synonym in English. They call it ikhtilaful alfaz wa ittifaqul ma'ani. The wordings are different, but the meaning is the same. That's the first difference they had amongst themselves. Even though they agreed that it's in seven dialects, seven most prevalent dialects in the dialects of the Arabs, they differed on two things. The first thing, I already mentioned it to you. The second thing is that they differed upon is, are these dialects, all of them, present in the Qur'an till now? And is it still in the Qur'an now? Has it remained in the Qur'an? Or has it been abrogated and nothing has been left except the dialect of Quraysh? Those are two views. Is it present? Is it still in the Qur'an, those dialects? Is it through the whole entire Qur'an like that? Or has it been abrogated and removed? The view that says that it's present in the Qur'an and it hasn't been abrogated is the view held by Abu Ubaid al-Qasim al-Sallam and those who follow him in that view. Another group of scholars, they hold the opposite opinion, like Al-Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari and those who agree with him. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari believes they have all been abrogated and the dialect of Quraysh only remains. The ones who said that it remains in the Qur'an, those who said that the dialects are still present in the Qur'an and it has not been abrogated, they differed amongst themselves. What are those dialects? Which dialects is it that still remains in the Qur'an? Can you precisely mention them? They differed amongst themselves. Even though they agreed it's seven, but they differed amongst themselves. And there's a poet who summarized them all together, and these are the seven most famous ones. Give or take, there are one or two that are changed around, but these are the seven most common ones that majority of the scholars hold, and they are summarized in two lines of poetry. The poet, he said, ثَقِيفٌ قُرَيْشٌ مَعْهُدَيْلٌ هَوَازِنٌ كنانة تتلوها تميم مع اليمن لغات أتى القرآن فيها منزلا أخي هاك نظما لا يراد به ثمن. He said it's ثقيف, number one, قريش, number two, مع هذيل, three, هذيل, four, هوازن, five, كنانة, six, تميم, and seven, اليمن. He said لغات أتى القرآن فيها منزلا. It is the dialect which the Qur'an came with. أَخِي هَاكَ نَظْمًا. My brother, these are lines of poetry. لَا يُرَادُ بِهِ ثَمَنْ. I'm not intending to get any money for it. So these two lines, or more like the first line of poetry, he summarizes the seven Arab dialect in which the Qur'an came on. But that's not all agreed upon. There are differences in this regard as well. Now we've mentioned the first opinion that deserves to be given weight, that has either دليل في الجملة or شبه دليل. They have evidence either in general or that which resembles a evidence. Now we're going to go into the second view. The second view of scholars whose opinion has weight, it's strongly argued, is that the seven أحرف is referring to the differences that happen and are found in the recitation of the Qur'an. They said it is the different changes, forms that are found in the recitation of the Qur'an. This opinion is attributed to many of the scholars and many of the reciters. From them, Ibn Qutaybata al-Dinawari rahimahullah, who died the year 276, Al-Qadhi Abu Bakr al-Baqilani, who died the year 403 Hijriya, Abu al-Fadl al-Raziyu, who died the year 606 Hijriya, and Ibn al-Jazari, who died the year 833 Hijriya, and other than them. These great scholars, they said, the Ahruf al-Sab'a is referring to seven categories, or seven different forms in which the recitation of the Qur'an changes. Inshallah ta'ala, I'll give you an example. What these great scholars that I mentioned, like Ibn Qutaybah al-Dinawari and Abu al-Fadl al-Razi and Ibn al-Jazari, all agree upon is that it's seven different ways in which the Qur'an is recited. It's not dialects or Arab dialects. No, it's seven different ways in which the Qur'an is recited. Now pay attention here. these seven different ways in which it's recited, they differed amongst themselves, even though they united that it's seven. When they came to giving the examples for those sevens, or categorizing those seven, Ibn Qutaybah al-Dinawari said something. Abu al-Fadl al-Razi said something. Ibn al-Jazari, he also said something. I here, inshallah ta'ala, have chosen the opinion of Abu al-Fadl al-Razi. I'm going to mention it. But they are very close. It's not much of a difference. It's very close. But I've just chosen Abu al-Fadl al-Razi since his opinion is not mentioned a lot by people. Majority of the people, they choose to mention Ibn al-Jazari's one. And so I chose to mention Abu al-Fadl al-Razi's one. Even though they're very similar, the differences are very minute. Let me go through the seven. Then you'll have an understanding of what this part is, inshallah ta'ala, or this view is. This view, they said, that when the Qur'an is recited, and they looked at the qira'at and the way that the Qur'an is recited, they came to the conclusion that the Qur'an, it changes in its recitation in seven different ways. And those are the only changings. And they said, that's what the Ahruf al-Sab'ah is referring to. I'll give you an example. The Qur'an, in some places, there are variations and differences in a noun, for example. Is it a singular or is it a plural noun? Is it a dual noun? Is it a masculine noun? Is it a feminine noun? I'll give you an example. قوله تعالى, Allah تبارك وتعالى, he says, لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ, Allah تبارك وتعالى, he says. That's one recitation. Another recitation suggests and says, that it's not read as لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ, but rather لِأَمَانَتِهِمْ. The difference here is, one is plural, which is لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ is plural, and لِأَمَانَتِهِمْ is singular. And Ibn Kathir, he recited it, and Ibn Kathir is from the seven Qurra, he recited it as لِأَمَانَتِهِمْ, as a singular. Whereas the remaining reciters, they all read it as لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ. So they said this is an example of what the Prophet meant, that the Qur'an was sent down in seven ahruf. The second, they said it means اختلاف في تصريف الأفعال. Now, differences that occur in the verbal morphology. For example, قوله تعالى, the statement of Allah, فَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا بَاعِدْ بَيْنَ أَسْفَارِنَا. فَقَالُوا, Allah said, they said, رَبَّنَا, our Lord, بَاعِدْ, distance between, بَيْنَ أَسْفَارِنَا, between our travelings and our journeys. The word, the ayah has been read in three ways. One, I've already read it for you, which is the recitation of the seven Qurra. They all read it like that, except Ibn Kathir and Abu Amr and Hisham. They read it as رَبَّنَا بَاعِدْ, the seven reciters. Other than Ibn Kathir and Abu Amr and Hisham, they all read it as رَبَّنَا بَاعِدْ بَيْنَ أَسْفَارِنَا. Ya'qub al-Hadrami, who's from the 10, he recited it as رَبُّنَا بَاعَدَ بَيْنَ أَسْفَارِنَا. That's a difference in terms of the verbal morphology. Because رَبَّنَا بَاعِدْ is a command. It's a talab, you're requesting from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas رَبُّنَا, our Lord, بَاعَدَ is a past tense. It's a past tense verb. Another recitation, which is the recitation of Ibn Kathir and Abu Amr and Hisham, which is رَبَّنَا بَاعِدْ بَيْنَ أَسْفَارِنَا بِالتَّشْدِيدِ, and removing the alif. So that's the second type of the changes that occur in the recitation that they're referring to. The third one, they said, is اختلاف that happens in the grammatical analysis في وجوه الإعراب. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's verse, وَإِن تَكُ حَسَنَةً يُضَاعِفَهَا وَإِن تَكُ حَسَنَةً. You can read it بالنصب. You can also read it بالرفع, which is وَإِن تَكُ حَسَنَةٌ يُضَاعِفَهَا. نافع and Ibn Kathir and Abu Ja'far, they recited it برفع التاء. They said, وَإِن تَكُ حَسَنَةٌ. That's the qira'ah of نافع, Ibn Kathir and Abu Ja'far. Whereas the other remaining reciters, they read it as وَإِن تَكُ حَسَنَةً. The fourth variation and difference that occurs in the recitation they mention is ikhtilaf that happens in terms of addition and subtraction that occurs in wordings. Sometimes a word is omitted. Sometimes something is added. Sometimes something is subtracted. Like for example, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. There's another qira'ah which is فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. The word huwa has been removed. The qira'ah of Nafi' and Ibn Amir and Abu Ja'far is removing the huwa. There's no huwa in there. Whereas the qira'ah of the other remaining reciters is that they recite it as فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. The fifth type of difference in recitation that the great imams were referring to is اختلاف من حيث التقديم والتأخير. Differences in terms of word order. Which word comes before which? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَقَاتَلُوا وَقُتِلُوا. Here we have Hamza and Kisa'i and Khalaf al-Ashir putting forward what? Putting first, قُتِلُوا وَقَاتَلُوا. Whereas the other remaining Qurra, they read it as the way I mentioned, which is وَقَاتَلُوا وَقُتِلُوا. This is a difference in terms of what word comes before which word. The sixth, which is اِخْتِلَافٌ فِي الْإِبْدَالِ. Difference that occur in terms of the alternation between the consonant or the words. For example, قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى هُنَالِكَ تَبْلُو كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا أَسْلَفَتْ. هُنَالِكَ تَبْلُو. Tablu here is the qira'ah of the majority. So you have the qira'ah of Hamza and Kisa'i and Khalaf al-Ashir. They recited it as هُنَالِكَ تَتْلُو كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا أَسْلَفَتْ. You see? Whereas the baquna, the remaining scholars, they recited it as هُنَالِكَ تَبْلُو كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا أَسْلَفَتْ. These six variations or differences is what they're referring to. And the seventh and last and final one is اِخْتِلَافٌ فِي اللَّهَجَاتِ. Differences that occur in terms of the dialects. You have the fath, you have the imala, you have the tarqiq and tafkhim and the idhar and the idgham. These, they said, which are the dialects that happen and occur in the Qur'an, they said these seven are what the sab'ah, Al-Ahruf al-Sab'ah is referring to. It's not referring to seven dialects of the Arabs. It's referring to seven different types of way in which the Qur'an is recited today. This view, as I mentioned, is attributed to Al-Imam Ibn Qutaybah, is attributed to Al-Qadi Abu Bakr al-Baqilani, Abu al-Fadl al-Razi, and Ibn al-Jazari rahimahullah. Ibn al-Jazari came to this opinion after 30 something years of thinking and pondering and contemplating. This is what his conclusion became, that it's what? أَوْجُهُ الْقُرْآنِيَّةِ الَّتِي يَقَعُ بِهَا التَّغَيُّرُ وَالِاخْتِلَافِ الْكَلِمَاتِ الْقُرْآنِيَةِ. The variations and the differences that occur in the recitation of the Qur'an. The differences I mentioned it to you, those seven differences is what it means, the hadith أُنزِلَ الْقُرْآنُ عَلَى سَبْعَةِ أَحْرُفٍ. That the Qur'an was sent down in seven أحرف. Ibn al-Jazari, Ibn Qutaybah al-Dinawari, Abu al-Fadl al-Razi, Abu Bakr al-Baqilani, they say these are the seven. Where Ibn Abdul Barr, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Abu Ubaid Qasim al-Sallam, Ibn Wahb and others are saying it's seven lahajat, min lahajat al-Arab. It's referring to seven dialects of the Arabs. It's not talking about recitation and ways and method it's recited. It's a dialect. I hope this explains to you the two most strongest arguments regarding the seven ahruf. Now, inshallah ta'ala, what I'm going to do is I'm going to sift through those opinions, go through one after the other, and inshallah ta'ala bring a conclusion of what is the strongest opinion. I'll see you guys in the next episode. BarakAllahu feekum wa jazakumullahu khayran.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.